thank you for attending here at St. Martin of Tours as we celebrate the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany. Our liturgy of the Holy Eucharist Rite 2 will continue on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Together, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you those secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see, who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from 1 Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, For an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place. And there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I might proclaim the message there also. For this is what I came to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Good morning, St. Martin's.
Good morning.
Bishop Hughes is the diocesan bishop of the Diocese of Newark, and she introduces Black History Month on their webpage with this quote. That annual celebration that takes place in our country every February 1st through March 1st, where we take an intentional look at the achievements of African Americans, the things that they have done, said, written, changed, discovered, experienced, and the impact that those people and their actions have had on the history of our nation. It is a time of great celebration and of discovery, and of learning and drawing together more closely as a community across the lines of color. So this is our Sunday kickoff of Black History Month here at St. Martin's. Now I know some of you have already been attending movies for 2 weeks and I'm lagging behind, but this is our official Sunday kickoff of Black History, and I'm also hoping that with kickoff in there, it helps some of us that are in withdrawal from the NFL and will be in more serious withdrawal after next Sunday night. Just trying to help us out. Today we will learn and celebrate the life and contributions of Dr. Charles Willie. You may have heard his name before because you've heard me talk about the Philadelphia 11 before, but this is a Philadelphia 11 related story. But Charles Willie had a really big important part in it. Dr. Willie was the first African American to be elected to the vice presidency of the House of Deputies. The House of Deputies being within the Episcopal Church's bicameral system of government, one of the two houses along with the House of Bishops that make up General Convention. It was anticipated that Dr. Willie, because of his early arrival at the vice presidency of the House of Deputies, he would probably become the first also president of the House of Deputies as an African American. And that's pretty much the most powerful elected position a layperson can hold in the Episcopal Church. The reason that he didn't become the president was that in 1974, he resigned in protest over the House of Bishops' response to the ordination of the Philadelphia 11. He voted with his feet. Now, Charles Willie is an amazing example of someone who was working for social justice, but he didn't stop with working on what affected him most directly, which was clearly racism and would have been a big enough project for his lifetime. But he stood in solidarity with the cause of women in the Episcopal Church. And a personal story that was told in an interview that he gave was that he had sons and daughters, and in looking at them, he couldn't imagine saying to his daughters that they couldn't do what they dreamed of in the way that he responded to his sons. But Charles Willie did this to the point of risking his reputation in the church and voluntarily laying down his career in the House of Deputies, something that it had taken generations of African Americans for him to achieve, and that brought some disappointment from his community of color. What I didn't know until more recent research this week was that he proposed a plan to the Presiding Bishop Allen at that time, that could have changed the course of church history in terms of the pain and misunderstanding that came after the ordination of the Philadelphia 11. But that plan wasn't listened to. So despite being ignored by the presiding bishop, Willie went on with his stellar problem-solving skills to propose school desegregation plans, the author of the one that was the city of Boston's desegregation plan, was copied, and he was a consultant for 8 or 10 other cities that did the same thing.
He went on to publish 100 articles and 35 books in his career. He served as the department chair of sociology at Syracuse, where he had actually done his graduate work, and he retired after a distinguished career at Harvard Graduate School of Education, where he taught until 1999. By that time, he was 72, but then he decided to teach part-time for another 10 years until he was 82. Stepping back, let me give you the timeline for Charles Willie's involvement in the House of Deputies. In 1970, Charles Willie was elected the first African-American vice president of the House of Deputies. This is also the same year that for the first time, the women were seated as deputies. So there were dioceses that began to elect women to represent them at the General Convention and send them as deputies as early as the 40s. And they would travel to General Convention and they would not be seated. So they could go to the gallery and they could watch, but they weren't seated with voice and vote despite being elected by their diocese to do so. So at that convention, the resolution on the ordination of women failed. And it would have passed if the split delegation rule wasn't in place, but if you had a delegation of four, it was 2-2, all four went to the negative. In between conventions, it was proposed that that canon be changed. And by the 1973 General Convention, it had not. So the resolution went up again, passed in the House of Bishops, but failed in the House of Deputies. Again, based on the split delegations counting as all four votes to the no. July 29, 1974, the 11 women who had already met all the canonical requirements and were ordained as deacons in their diocese worked with three retired bishops, one of whom was the father of one of the persons to be ordained. And they planned an ordination in Philadelphia. Charles Willie was the preacher at the ordination, and it was at the Church of the Advocate, a parish famous for its involvement in civil rights, and who had a rector that already was equipped for this because he had taken a stand on many important things in the city of Philadelphia, and he was ready for the death threats and the bomb threats and the extra security they would need to host this event. They did need all of that, and they also didn't publish where the event was going to be, and even to the families of people that were attending, until 5 or 6 days beforehand, in fear that the word would get out too fast and it would be a target for terrorism. They were ordained, and then there was a huge kerfuffle in the church, which some of you may have lived through. But in those immediate days and week, there was so much going on that Charles Willie wrote to the House of Bishops and the presiding bishop to propose a special convention be called to address the matter. And I'm going to read you the text of the letter. It's not that long, but I think his exact words are really important. Dear Bishop Allen, I have been thinking of ways of dealing with the ordination service in Philadelphia, July 29th, 1974, which I know has caused great agony for you. I wish there were some other way to bring about the ordination of women without engaging in an irregular procedure. But the church refused to recognize the full personhood of women twice during this decade, and I no longer could cooperate in their oppression. I wish that you had stood with me. Nevertheless, I can respect your desire to see the orderly procedures of the church followed. What is done is done, and from my perspective, what is done was right. If the only way that the church can deal with irregularity is by discipline, suspension, deposition, and punishment, it will demonstrate to the world that its pious concepts about love, justice, mercy, and forgiveness are platitudes. Probably one of the best ways of implementing these concepts is by official action on the part of General Convention to call a special General Convention to deal with the ordination of women that will lay this issue to rest. This letter, therefore, is a sincere request to you to lay before the House of Bishops, which there was a meeting coming up, they called a special one in August, lay before them a proposal for a special convention to be held immediately. And this could be our finest hour. Please let me know if I can be of any help in planning for the action requested. Best wishes, Charles Willie. The presiding bishop, for reasons that are not included in most materials I reviewed, did not take him up on that offer. Presiding Bishop Allen instead called an emergency meeting of the House of Bishops, which famously took place at the O'Hare Airport. They flew in and they just didn't even leave the airport, they just went right to the hotel. And during that meeting, which was held in some sort of a non-standard, people talk about hallways and I don't know, they didn't really have a spot reserved given that it was on the fly. They voted 128 to something, seven or something, not like 127, but 128 to just us seven, to declare the ordinations of the 11 irregular and order the women not to exercise their priesthood, and then threw down the gauntlet and said that any priest or ordained person that helped them to exercise their priesthood would be subject to discipline, which several were, and I can fill you in on that another day. In 1975, four more women were ordained in Washington, D.C. by Bishop Barrett. So we come up to the 1976 convention, which is where they had kicked the can down to, this is where we're going to decide this. And indeed it was decided. The ordination of women passed both houses. But the Philadelphia 11 and the Washington 4 were still in limbo for the better part of 2 years because they gave it over to the individual bishops in their dioceses to figure out how to regularize their ordinations that had taken place previously. The bishops were also offered a conscience clause. So if they felt like they couldn't possibly ordain a woman, they could state that and that could be the rule in their diocese. A number of dioceses used this in the beginning, partly as a transition, and then a number of them persisted in it. But the last holdout diocese that didn't ordain women took that conscience clause for 34 years. The Diocese of Quincy did not ordain a woman until 2010. So August 18th of 1974, Charles Willie sent a letter to the presiding bishop stating that he was resigning as a protest against the inhumane treatment of women in the Episcopal Church, particularly women priests. That may not seem like a big deal, but given the lifelong process it takes to become the president of the House of Deputies, like he had made it and he had made it as a person of color and he was doing really important work on behalf of his community, as well as many other people who were watching him. And he resigned that to make sure that the bishops heard that he was serious, that this was injustice. So Charles Willie was a sociologist. He considered himself an applied sociologist. So he was concerned with solving social problems. His areas of research included desegregation, higher education, public health, race relations, urban community problems, and family life. One of his famous early books of his 35 was on the Black family. And it was the very first of the three names, Patrick Moynihan. We're spreading a lot of things in politics that basically said, you know, the Black family has got all these problems from slavery and it's just pathology and it's never gonna be any better. And Charles Willie published his research and said, you know what, the Black family is a miracle. The Black family having survived and its resilience and has all these cultural elements to it, it's a miracle and it should be supported and studied, and we're not talking about it as pathology anymore. And he really almost single-handedly turned that focus and tide. Willie was born in October 8th in 1927 in Dallas, Texas. He was the grandson of Louis Willie and they don't give the grandmother's name, but they were both former slaves. His own father was a Pullman porter, which at that time was a hard job in terms of being away from home, but it was also a protected job because the union for porters, the Black union for porters, was very strong. So it wasn't like iffy whether he would have work. He was just away from home a lot. His mother, Carrie Sykes, was one of the first Black women to earn a college degree in Texas. That sounds like fun. But could not teach in the segregated Dallas school system because she was married. Because it was Depression era, if your husband had a job, you couldn't work. She therefore homeschooled her children until they could ride in the back of the streetcars to their segregated schools. I'm sure that Charles' experience of riding around in a streetcar half a day before he got to a segregated school had something to do with how much genius he brought to the question of desegregating the Boston school system. He received a bachelor's degree from Morehouse College in 1948 and was literally not just classmates but friends with Martin Luther King. He got a master's degree from Atlanta University in 1949 and his PhD in sociology from Syracuse in 1957, where he stayed for 14 years before he went to Harvard. Charles Willie's resignation letter to the presiding bishop explains a concept that we now know as systemic racism, and I really thought we invented that somewhere in the last decade or so, because, you know, for a long time in anti-racism stuff, we didn't hear about systemic racism, and then, you know, that became really standard, but evidently there was a lot going on about that in 1974. Evidently that he has not been credited for it, as far as I know. So he wrote to the presiding bishop the following: "A concept of sin that is limited to personal action is too narrow and is of little utility in a complex industrial society. Institutional sin consists of those procedures and practices of organizations that harm individuals, whether or not intended. It can occur quite independently of the attitudes and motivations of the people who make up the organization. Indeed, institutional sin could be the unintended outcome of behavior that was thought to be helpful. Institutional sin, therefore, has to do with the effect, the impact, the outcome, rather than the intent of social interaction. The institutional sin of sexism or racism, for example, exists when the opportunities, obligations, and behavior of the people that are of one sex or race are limited in a way that is inequitable and unfair in comparison with people of another sex or race." And then he brings it home to the Episcopal Church. Again, writing to the presiding bishop, "Our sexist policies, procedures, and practice in the Episcopal Church have brought untold harm to many women. Now is the time to stop institutional sexism. The church is a good place in which to begin." Willie also included an explanation for the presiding bishop as to why he had preached at the ordination of the Philadelphia 11. And he says that what he said to himself was, "I participated in this service not because I wanted to speak out, but because I could not remain silent. Also, I speak neither as an officer of the church nor a professor of any school, but as a child of God who has decided to make no peace with oppression. And then I said to myself, I stand ready to suffer the consequences of my action." Willie had been trained in the same tradition of peaceful protest and civil disobedience that his friend Dr. King made famous. There are a few closing sentences from his letter of resignation to the presiding bishop. "Any religious authority that does not recognize the primacy of love over and against all other relationships in human society is false authority. One ought not to remain silent before false authority. My resignation was one way of calling attention to that kind of authority and a means of resisting it." Charles Willie took his baptismal covenant seriously, proclaiming by word and example the good news of Jesus Christ, seeking and serving Christ in all other persons, loving his neighbor as himself, and striving for justice and peace among all people, respecting the dignity of every human being. Despite his resignation from the House of Deputies, Charles Willie continued to be a member of the Episcopal Church for the rest of his life. He died in 2022 at the age of 94. In 2015, Dr. Willie was awarded the House of Deputies Service Award for his role around the ordination of women. His award arrived 39 years after his courageous action. Amen.
Our liturgy continues on page 358 with the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and unconscious trials. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from Father and Son. With the Father and Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are Form 1, found on page 383 in your book of common prayer, and the prayer list is found in your bulletin insert.
As we pray for those on our prayer lists, you are invited to join in these prayers. The prayer list can be found on your bulletin insert. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of South America. In the Diocesan cycle of prayer, for Champ Chickagami, EYC, and Plainsong Farm, and for St. John's in Otter Lake. In St. Martin's cycle of prayer, we pray for Nancy, Leslie, Mary, Tom, Romeo, Barbara, Doug, and Judy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Skip, our assisting bishop, for the standing committees of Eastern and Western Michigan, for Bonnie, Rayford, and Moises, the bishops of our companion diocese, for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, and for Craig, the Bishop of the Area Synod of the ELCA. For the Diocesan Canons Missioner, Katie, Sunil, and Tracy, for this gathering and for all priests and deacons, especially the clergy associated with this parish, Mary, Pat, Rick, and Mike. For Julianne, Jennifer, Lori, and all others discerning vocation to ordained or lay ministry, for our vestry and for all those seeking a deeper knowledge of God, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Joseph, our president, and Gretchen, our governor, for the leaders of all nations and for all in authority, give them wisdom and compassion. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Kalamazoo County, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve and protect it, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for all who are aging, who find their bodies having more and more limitations. Give them peace and patience to accept their body's natural changes, and give them joy and laughter with their loved ones and caregivers. We pray for those on our prayer list: Charlotte, Clayton, Dan,
Delia,
Jean,
Janelle,
Jenny,
Joanna,
Joe,
Joanna,
Sarah
Marie,
Haley,
Julie,
Bob,
Alan,
Jenna,
Linda,
Jim,
Pam,
Christopher,
Juliana,
Karen,
Musette,
Sean,
Dorothy,
Madeline,
Bill,
Anna,
Tony,
Edward,
Christopher,
Carrie,
Jean,
Judy,
Mary Jo,
Sally,
Marjorie,
Becky,
Sherry,
Joe,
Bill,
Kate,
Deb,
Janet,
Dean,
Marianne,
Pat,
Leonard,
and
Penny.
And for those we now name aloud or in the silence of our hearts. For the aged and infirm, for the widows and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, and for all those who have no one to pray for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for the prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who have died in February's past, Ernest Albright, Shirley Ashba, Kirsten Cookson, Marvel Cunningham, Arthur DeLong, David Noel, Maud Farnham, James Garland, Joe Wynn, Freda Holly, William Hollingshed, Cedric Hunter, Baby Girl Cuck, Elizabeth Lewis, Joanne Lewis, Robert Lucky, James Mosby Jr., Royce Nelson, Joseph Ritchie, Vivian Robertson, William Walker, Nancy Webster. For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all involved in seeking peaceful solutions in Gaza, Israel, Ukraine, Russia, and the Sudan, we cannot comprehend the suffering of those who have lived in the darkness where there is war, terrorism, cruelty, and injustice. We pray with children who are too exhausted to laugh or cry, who know little of life except hunger or waiting. We pray with those fleeing for their lives with no place to call home. We pray with the many aid agencies who work to bring them hope and healing. For those who suffer from terrorism, racism, or religious persecution, for deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the communion of St. Martin of Tours and for all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To thee, O Lord, our God.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, thy servants, who now live by faith, may with joy behold your Son that is coming, in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
What does the Lord require of us?
To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God.
Amen. All things come from thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. We will continue with Eucharistic Prayer B, page 367. If you're able, please stand.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
In your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me.
Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be made acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Martin of Tours and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing.
No.
God, for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving.
Amen.
Amen. God in Christ.
Thank you.
Inside the back cover of your prayer book. Please, when I begin, pray it with me. Can I put my hands on your head? Let us pray. Watch over your child, O Lord, as her days increase. Bless and guide her wherever she may be. Strengthen her when she stands. Comfort her when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise her up if she falls. And in her heart, may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of her life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Penny, I bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Chloe, I bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You now have the opportunity, not the mandate, a lot of pressure, but not the mandate, to come to the microphone and tell us the best thing about this past year, something good about this past year, and your hope for the coming year.
This past year was a trip to the Netherlands with my daughters. This year has kind of had a strange start with my me being sick and my great-granddaughter being sick, but we're all doing good now, and thank you so much for all your prayers. And here's hoping the rest of the year goes well for everybody.
Is your granddaughter?
She has a urinary tract infection and is something in the kidneys that is familial. You ever heard of mother? We were not aware of that, that the mother had a problem also. And so she had E. coli in her urine, which could have come from when she was born. It took 6 weeks for that.
So, what I wondered is if you have met her yet.
No, I've still not been up there to see her yet. So, here's hoping.
I'm glad the news is good.
Yeah.
This past year, a good thing was I started high school. And something I'm looking forward to is meeting more people and having more fun the rest of the school year.
If you're able, please stand and let's praise God for Penny and Chloe.
Praise God, how you are blessings flow.
Having surgery this coming Thursday, and I will, with her permission, put my hands on her head and pray her and anoint for her. Gracious God, we thank you for Pat. We thank you for everything about her, for the ways especially that she has inspired us and been an example to us. Pat, I bless you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. As you are outwardly anointed with this oil, may God's Holy Spirit inwardly anoint you, giving your spirit courage and hope, trust, and especially joy and love. Amen.
Amen.
Do you want to say anything?
Oh, prayers are always welcome. I'm expecting everything to go just fine, so I'm sure everything will be fine, but I still would love your prayers. Thank you.
Thank you. If you have an announcement, please come to the microphone.
So St. Martin's is amazing. Thanks to Mary for sending out the email on meals for Pat and I. Our calendar is already full. And so thank you for everyone who's already contacted me, and I'll be getting back, Pam Fenno and I are coordinating that, and I'll be getting back to you shortly with details. My understanding is they just love liver and parsley casserole. So we want to make that the best. Also, there's a card for Bill and Kay Hansen out on in the Great Hall, and if you'd like to chat a note, we'll pop that in the mail to them. Thank you.
The youth is going to be doing an intergenerational diversity project for Black History Month. So we would invite you to pick up a piece of paper. There's some blank paper out there. Or we've got some paper that they can demonstrate here that already has some traced hands on it. If you take it and decorate it with whatever media you want, there's some different options out there. Crayons, markers, pencils, pastels.
You can make it realistic or abstract, but please put it back on the table and return it by February 11th.
Can you hold up the... So Faith is holding up some examples. Just decorate them. We'll be happy to cut them out for you. And with these, we'll be making a piece of artwork for our parish, where we're going to do a collage with these.
When are they due?
They are due next Sunday.
As a movie buff, I just want to advertise the Soup, Supper, and Movie that's coming up this Wednesday. This is an award-winning film, Harriet, about abolitionist Harriet Tubman. It is an amazing, amazing movie. Top quality production values. It is, this is a movie you do not want to miss. So that's just my recommendation.
And who's asking the time?
Oh, it's 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock for the Soup Supper part of it, and the movie starts at 6:30.
Two things before the blessing. One is I have my phone with me, and if any of you are willing to have your picture taken, saying hi to Bill or Bill and Kay, or even doing a short greeting video. I put together the ones that we got, I think it was last week, and sent it to them, and they really enjoyed it. So if you're willing to do that, catch me right after the service and we'll do that. Secondly, for anybody on Vestry, there is the form to sign on the counter in the sacristy. If you could sign that before you leave, please. Please stand for the blessing. You are welcome to sing with me.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you.
You in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah.